Well, if that don't light your fire, your wood's wet. Anybody know what that's from? The movie The Patriot. That's right. That's right. Thank God for America. We were going to be delivering a message today from Ezekiel, that we advertised in the church newsletter. But with the events of this past week, we decided to change horses in the middle of the stream. And I hope that's all right with you. I used to watch football, pro football. I still watch college football till it became political. But if you ever watched Monday Night Football, the famous country singer, Hank Williams Jr., always for many years played the theme song, sang famous line, which asks a question, and that question is, one person knows, two people, that's right, are you ready for some football? Well, I would ask you, are you ready for some fireworks? Well, we'll see about that. I won't get us into trouble. Well, maybe we'll see. So I think we'll be all right. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we bow to no one except the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, heaven is your throne. The earth is the footstool of your feet. We know that your word is true because it casts perfect judgment and assessment of what goes on in the world. Yet we're reminded, as our brother read to us, the Lord is on his throne. You are sovereign. You are supreme. You are awake. We know, Father, that there's not always justice in this life. We learned that in Sunday school, that Paul deserved to be set free, but he wasn't, because the rulers were looking for a bribe. They were looking to satisfy the people more than satisfy the truth. Father, today, we are about the truth. For you said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. We know, Father, that real freedom in this life comes from truth, not lies. It comes from Jesus, who set us free from sin and placed our feet on a rock that cannot be shaken. So, Lord, today, encourage us and convict us and comfort us and bless us in this hour. And we pray in the name of our Lord Jesus, who brought heaven down to earth. Amen. Where were they? Didn't they hear the sound of the boots hitting the streets? They were in their buildings made of stone and stained glass. They were singing their songs, such as, a mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Are you familiar with that song? That's enough singing. Martin Luther wrote it. Didn't they hear the sound of the children weeping? Perhaps they kept telling themselves, this is a Christian nation. They were a Christian people founded on Christian principles. They had a church in every town, on every block, in every city. Their universities were the admiration of the world. It couldn't be happening there. So they kept singing their songs, thinking that they were safe in their Christian nation. But they came swaggering, bullying men in brown shirts, their black hobnail boots marching down the streets as the church sang her songs. They went into the shops of the Jews, smashed their windows as a sign of things to come. The church kept on singing on Gut on Fatherland, or of God and country in German. But that was long after the marriage of God and country had become an unholy marriage when the nightmare of a man stood up and asked all to say, "There is but ein Führer." That is Adolf Hitler. The church sang her little songs. Where was the church in the country that had given the world Martin Luther and the Reformation? Where was the church in the country that had taken the cross as their national emblem before they took the swastika? Did you know that? Their national emblem was the cross before it was the swastika. Where was the church and why were they so silent in the face of the nightmare of the Third Reich? And I ask the question, where is the church in Germany today? You will not find much of the church in Germany today. What is happening in America is what happened in Europe in the 20th century. We're just catching up with them. Our brother Rusty Swofford, who has spoken at this pulpit many times, wrote, and I quote, "America is headed to the European way of life, a godless society with government control, limited freedoms, and universalism of all religions." He said, and I quote, "I've traveled to Europe for over 25 years. Evangelism is at a standstill. The church has been in decline for years. Materialism is their god, and many idol-worshiping pagans have moved in and now outnumber the local population. Europe is at a point of no return, a lost society, and only a small remnant of Christians remain." Close quote. And I would say to that comment, welcome to Berlin. You see, much of what claims to be Christian in America really isn't. It's a warm, fuzzy, so-called spiritual psychology that never really addresses man's biggest problem of sin and his rebellion against God. Many people are upset based upon what is going on in our country since last Tuesday, and I'm sure some of you are in that number. I won't ask for a show of hands. We know there's been fraud in the election. Censorship is going on in the following 13 points I'm going to share with you in my introduction. These are facts. These are not my little opinion. They're facts. As we address this topic that Ethan read from Psalms, when the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? Poll watchers in Philadelphia and Michigan were refused access to watch the counting of votes. If you don't have anything to hide, why try to hide? In Michigan, windows were covered with paper so that poll watchers could not see through the clear, plain glass. In one state, poll watchers were escorted out to the raucous cheers of those who were left behind to count. Someone is chipping away at the foundation. You see, when the foundations are destroyed, my mom and dad were election judges when I was a kid. I remember them telling me when they counted ballots, there was a representative from this side of the fence and one from that side of the fence. It was done in honesty, not secrecy under the cover of darkness. I saw a ballot from the state of Michigan where the person who voted was born in 1900. Anybody here born in 1900? That's 120 years ago. You see, someone's chipping away at the foundation. People in Nevada showed up to vote and were not allowed to vote because someone had voted in their name. Thousands of people voted in Nevada who no longer live in Nevada. Dead people voted in Nevada, and I'm sure other states too. That doesn't come from me. That comes from Adam Laxalt, who's the former Attorney General of Nevada. You see, someone's chipping away at the foundation. In Arizona, people were told to vote with a Sharpie marker. However, when they put their vote in the voting machine, it rejected it because they had filled it in with a Sharpie marker. Someone's chipping away at the foundation. In Michigan, the computer system gave 6,000 votes to the wrong candidate. This software was used in 47 other counties in that state, as well as in other states. It gave 6,000 votes to the wrong candidate in the state of Michigan. Many of our president's tweets have been taken down from Twitter because they are rejecting his First Amendment's right to free speech. They're censoring his tweets. Someone is chipping away at the foundation. The state of Florida had over 10 million people who voted. We say hi to you Floridians here. Our weather's as warm as yours is. Ha, ha, ha. You see, Florida counted their mail-in ballots before Election Day. That way, they didn't know how many they had to count afterwards to make up the difference. They counted all of their mail-in ballots before Election Day, not after, according to their governor. Someone's chipping away at the foundation. Ever since our president was elected and before he was inaugurated, there have been many attempts to undermine his duly elected position by the people of this country. Former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn was set up by the FBI. The federal police in this country, he was set up by the highest police department in this country. Someone's chipping away at the foundation. Our president was impeached by the House of Representatives over asking Ukraine about looking into something the former vice president said. The former vice president told Ukraine, if you don't fire the prosecutor, you're not getting the money. Close quote. Since when do American vice presidents or presidents tell other nations what to do with their prosecutors? But our president was impeached, at least by the House of Representatives he was, over an inquiry about what someone else did. Someone's chipping away at the foundation. Now, I want to show you a picture. Take a look at this picture. Do we have the picture? There we go. I don't know who the guy is on the right. The guy on the left, his name is Pence. P-E-N-C-E. He might look like someone you know. He is the brother of our vice president. His name is Greg. And he is a member of the United States House of Representatives from the great state of Indiana, 6th District. Last December, I had the privilege of being given a tour of the United States Capitol with my brother and his two grandchildren, grandson, granddaughter, and his daughter, my niece, a behind-the-scenes tour, even into the House chamber where the State of the Union address is given by Mr. Pence. That picture is taken on the Capitol balcony, looking, behind us is the National Mall. While we were eating lunch in the House dining room, I was sitting next to Mr. Pence, and he said to me, and I quote, "We have proof that the Russian steel dossier is a fraud." Close quote. He told me that as I sat right next to him. We have proof that it is a fraud. And yet, it was perpetuated and put on our country as something our president did to collude with the Russians to steal the election. Straight from the horse's mouth. The Mueller report cost millions of dollars, and over 2 years it proved that our president did nothing wrong. Someone's chipping away at the foundation. And number 12, the media has done everything they can to discredit and destroy our president even before he was elected. Someone's chipping away at the foundation. Last night, Rick and I were eating dinner, and I was looking for Justice with Judge Jeanine Pirro on Fox News. Well, I turned on Fox News at 8 o'clock. Rick and I are eating dinner. My family's all went out of town, some this way, some that way. Rick and I are hanging out. Justice with Judge Jeanine Pirro wasn't on Fox News last night. Do you know why? Fox News has censored Justice Judge Jeanine and taken her off the air. Someone is chipping away at the foundations. In Psalms 11 that Ethan read to us, David asked a question. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? By the time of King David's life, Israel had existed for 1,000 years, beginning with their father Abraham. David became king after Saul, who was a man after God's own heart, wrote many of the Psalms, but Israel had just come out of a 300-year dark period called the period of the Judges. You know what the Bible says in the book of Judges twice? It closes by saying, there was no king in Israel. Every man did what was right in his own eyes. Does that sound familiar? Every man did what was right in his own eyes. There was no king in Israel. And so David said, when the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? Well, I want to answer that question today, 3,000 years later. And I want to give three answers. The first one is, we have to remember that the Lord is in control. The Lord is in control. Ethan read to us in verse 4, the Lord is in His holy temple. Did you know that God is never surprised by anything? God never turns to the angels and says, you know, never saw that coming. God is not surprised by anything that goes on. He's always on duty. He even works the night shift. Daniel 2, 20 and 21 says, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, to whom belongs wisdom and might. He changes times and seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings. Now let me say something to you that here is very important. We have to do some teaching on this because there's a lot of misunderstanding amongst Christian people and non-Christian people too about texts like this. You cannot take this text and apply it to our nation like it was applied to Israel. You cannot. You must understand that Israel was unique in the Old Testament. Israel was God's spiritual nation, but Israel was also God's physical nation. They had territory. They had property they owned. And so God raised up Babylon to spank Israel's behind. He raised up Assyria before that to spank Israel's behind. Then 150 years later, He raised up Babylon to spank Judah's behind. They went to captivity for 70 years. God raised up Nebuchadnezzar, Belshazzar, but He also deposed them and raised up Cyrus of the Medo-Persian kingdom. But you can't take that text and apply it to America, because why not? Because America is not God's nation. The church is God's nation. We are the spiritual Israel of God. I'm simply trying to show you that God is in control, even though there's not always justice in this life. Let's Look, for example, Jesus said to Pilate in John 19:11, "You would have no power over me unless it has been given to you from above." In other words, what you're doing to me, you'd be out of business if my Father wasn't allowing it. Right? Revelation 1:5, from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, firstborn of the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth. Yeah, Jesus is the King of kings, isn't he? Psalms 37:12-13. The wicked plots against the righteous and gnashes at him with his teeth. The Lord laughs at him, for he sees that his day is coming. Isn't that great? The wicked plots and they think they're doing things and God just laughs. He scoffs at them. There is coming a day when God will make right every wrong. Every injustice, he will make it right. He is the supreme ruler. The old hymn says, "This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is still the ruler yet." And so, first of all today, let us remember that regardless of what's going on in the land of the free, God is in control. He will have the last word. Secondly, devote yourselves to prayer and fasting. God calls us to pray and fast in Scripture. Devote yourselves to prayer and fasting. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 says this. First of all, "Then I urge that entreaties and prayers, petitions and thanksgivings be made on behalf of all men." But Paul qualifies it for kings and those in authority. "So that we may lead a," what? "Tranquil, quiet life in all godliness and dignity." Isn't that the kind of life you want to live? You want to live a life in peace. You want to be able to worship God. You want to be able to preach the word. You don't want anybody interfering with you, do you? Interfering with your rights that God gave you. Not the government gave you, the rights that God gave you. So Paul, he penned these words and they are authoritative. You know why? Because Paul said in 1 Corinthians, "The things that I write to you are the commandments of the Lord." So this is not Paul's opinion. This is Jesus speaking through Paul. Are you with me? He says we're to pray for kings. And in Paul's day and time, the kings were the Roman government. And those kings were oppressing Christians and they were killing Christians, and eventually they erased Paul's life too. But yet Paul said we're to pray for those people who are in authority. Why? We may lead a peaceful, quiet life in dignity and godliness. Here's a text that many people are confused about. 2 Chronicles 7:14. "My people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, and I will hear from heaven, will forgive their sin and heal their land." Let me clarify again, I've already done that, I guess, in the first point, a misconception that people have here. But repetition is good for us. I see people all over Facebook in good faith, and that's wonderful, quoting this text and thinking that text applies to America. That text applies to Israel, who was God's nation in the Old Testament, who had rebelled against God and fallen down worshiping idols, worshiping wood and stone. And the Lord is saying, if my people Israel will humble themselves and pray, and then I will bring healing to their land and their enemies who are oppressing them, I'll kick their enemies out. So if you're going to take that text, don't apply it to America. The application of that text today, if there is one, would be to the church. The church is God's nation. If God's people, the church, will humble themselves and pray and seek His face and turn from our sin, then God will give blessing. You see, as I've already said, America, I should put this in the first point, is not God's nation. The church is God's Israel, or His nation today. Paul said in Philippians 4:3, and I quote, "We," who's we? We who? Christians. "We're the true circumcision, If there's a true circumcision, that means there is a what? A false one. Who's the true? Who's the true circumcision? Let's answer that first. We who worship in the Spirit of God, Holy Spirit, and take pride in Jesus Christ and put no confidence in the flesh. Paul is saying, we who believe in Jesus Christ have the Holy Spirit, we're the true blue Jews. Who's the false circumcision? The Jews who reject Jesus and put confidence in the flesh, circumcising their male sons on the eighth day, as Paul talks about in that chapter. Paul's saying that the church, we're the true Jews. That's what the New Testament teaches. And so, we, Israel, we're called to pray in spite of the fact that there's not always justice in this life. I hear people saying, why is God letting this go on? God left Paul in prison. He hadn't done anything wrong. Acts 24 and 25. We've been saying that some Sunday school. Come join. Did Joseph do anything wrong down in Egypt? He refused Miss Potiphar's advances. She cried rape. They threw Joseph in prison. How long was Joseph in prison? At least 2 years. That's over 700 days. God leave him in there? Yeah, he did. And he finally got out. There's not always justice in this life. But regardless of that, we're called to pray. What about? Pray for our leaders, whether we like them or not, that we may lead a life of dignity, peacefulness, and godliness. 1 Timothy 2, 1 and 2. We've already read that. Abraham Lincoln said, and I quote, I've been driven to my knees many times by the overwhelming conviction that I had nowhere else to go. My own wisdom and that of all about me seemed insufficient for the day. Close quote. I've been driven to my knees when I had no other place to go, he said. That doesn't mean, again, there'll always be justice. God allows evil. He allows wrong. He allows falsehood and lies. The book of Revelation tells us that the Roman government was drunk with the blood of the church. God allowed that? Yeah, he did. Drunk with the blood of the saints. Chapter 6, verse 10, the martyrs asked God, how long will you refrain from avenging our blood on the earth? Revelation 6, 10, there's not always justice in this life. However, we're called to pray, but we're also called to fast. Let's do a little test here. How many of you think fasting is you can play along if you would, listed in the Bible 10 times or less, and you raise your hand when you think I'm onto it. How about 50 times or less? How about you don't want to play? How many think 100 times or less? Okay, several of you. How many think 500 times or less? Okay, the rest of you think I'm setting you up. The answer is 123 times. Some of those references, though, are references to the same thing in a different book, you understand? Like Jesus, quoting Jesus in Matthew and Mark. But there are 66 different references to fasting in the Bible. 66. Same amount of books, too. Here's what Jesus said about it. Matthew 6, 16 and 17. Now when you fast, you do not make a gloomy face as the hypocrites do. They distort their faces. They will not be noticed by people when they are fasting. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full. But as for you, when you fast, anoint your head and what's it say? Let's all read those last three words together. Let's say them together. Wash your face. Every year on Ash Wednesday, I want to tell several people, Jesus said, wash your face. That's what he said, isn't it? He said, when you fast, wash your face. Don't advertise it. I was in Bible college and I had a guy running around bragging he was fasting. Well, he was just having weight loss that day, man. You don't brag about fasting. It's a private thing. You don't have a shirt that says, hey, I'm fasting. But fasting takes different forms in Scripture. There's the absolute fast. Moses went without food or water for 40 days. God sustained him on the mountain when he got the Ten Commandments. Remember that? God sustained him. Jesus went without food for 40 days. I don't recommend that, although I know a preacher preaches in Missouri, he fasted for 40 days. He certainly did. He prepared for it, got in real good shape. He didn't go without water for 40 days. No, can't do that. But he went without food for 40 days. Then there's the fast, the normal fast, where you go without food, not water, but you go without food for a 24-hour period. That's the, if I can use the term, the normal fast. And then there's the partial fast that Daniel, Shadrach, and Meshach, and Abednego went through when they were in Babylon because they wouldn't eat the food that violated the Jewish law. But for our sake of understanding, let's talk about the normal fast. You go without food for one day. What's the purpose of it? Fasting is abstaining from food, not for a physical reason, but for a spiritual reason. Because at whatever's going on, there's more. Jesus said a man should not live by what? Bread alone. There are times when bread's not important. There are other things that come to the forefront. John Baird said, and I think we'll have the quote here, fasting has spiritual implications. It requires abstention from eating with religious motivation. It assumes that man is more than a physical body with physical appetites. Man is a spiritual being who lives in part in realms beyond the physical. To fast is to abstain from certain foods or to refrain from eating any food as a result of or in relationship to one's spiritual being. That's a good quote. There's a time to fast. When you've got something you need to work out with God. When Jesus was on the mountain of transfiguration, Peter, James, and John were up there with him. And the other nine disciples were down in the valley doing ministry. And they had this boy who was demon-possessed. And the father brought the boy to him, and the demon got the best of Jesus' disciples. So when Jesus, Peter, James, and John came down from the mountain, here they got this problem. And Jesus, bring the boy to me. And he casts out the demon and throws the boy into convulsions and terrorizes him on the way out. And after that was over, Jesus' disciples asked him privately, why were you successful and we weren't? Matthew 17, 21. Do we don't have that? Okay, I have it. This kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. Matthew 17, 21. This kind, Jesus said, does not go out except by prayer and fasting. Jesus was able to do what his disciples were not able to do. And that was his answer to their question. Why couldn't we do it? I think we should fast. You do what you want to do. I plan to fast, the normal fast, 24 hours without food, this coming Tuesday, 2 days from now, November the 10th. I invite you to come along and fast with me. If you want to fast tomorrow, that's fine. Whatever works for you. But I'm simply sharing with you, that's my plan for this Tuesday in regard to the condition of things in our country. And what is going on? I had something here I wanted to read. I thought, yes. My preacher friend Tom Claiborne out in Ohio said, and I quote, in regard to our current situation, I'm still praying for God to reveal the darkness and deception more clearly and reverse things. Close quote. He said, I'm still praying for God to reveal the darkness and deception. I think that's a good comment, don't you? And so I'm asking you to come and join me, if you can, on fasting this Tuesday. If you want us to do it tomorrow and Tuesday, that's fine too. You can do both days. We're called a pray and fast. Lastly, my last point is this. We have to fight for our liberty. We have to fight for liberty. Verse 1, Ethan read to us, how can you say to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain? No. Why? Because the Lord's in his holy temple. I'm not going to flee. How can you say, flee as a bird to your mountain? This is not a time to turn tail and run. Here's why. Martin Niemöller was a victim of Nazi Germany. Here's what he said in a famous quote. In Germany, they came for the Jews, but I didn't speak up because I wasn't a Jew. Then they came for the trade unionists, but I didn't speak up because I wasn't a trade unionist. Then they came for the Catholics, but I didn't speak up because I was a Protestant. Then they came for me. By that time, there was no one else left to speak up. Close quote. Martin Niemöller, very famous quote. Now, lest you think I'm over-dramatizing the point, and I don't think I am, there will come a time when they come for us too. And they will seek to silence we who cling to our Bibles and our guns. And if you think I'm off, you don't know what's going on. We are the deplorables liberal is a person who believes in many opinions. These people aren't liberals. They're strict conformists. Either you conform to our way or the highway. Fraud elections take place in North Korea or Cuba. You see, people like Kim Jong-un get 99.5% of the vote, and the other 0.5% get shot. That's where fraud elections take place in countries like Cuba. Give me 5 more minutes. 1 Kings 18, 17 through 21. I think there's a little lesson for us here. Ahab was king of Israel. What was his wife's name? Jezebel. They had left God long ago, turned to secularism, turned to idols. He said to Elijah the preacher, "Is that you, you troubler of Israel?" Elijah was up to the moment. He said, "I've not troubled Israel, but you and your father's house have, because you've forsaken the commandments of the Lord. You followed the Baals," that's idols. "Now then send and gather to me all Israel and Mount Carmel, to gather together 400 prophets of Baal, 400 prophets of Asherah, who eat at Jezebel's table." So Ahab sent a message among the sons of Israel and brought the prophets together at Mount Carmel. Elijah came near all the people and said, "How long will you hesitate between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him." But the people remained silent. They did not answer him a word. You see, Elijah was calling the people out. He was saying, "You got to take a stand. Either you're on the Lord's side or you're on the king's side. You can't be on both because the king's worshiping idols and we worship the Lord. Whose side are you on?" But Elijah turned it right back on Ahab. When he blamed the preacher for causing trouble, he said, "No, not me, you. You're the one who's troubling our country because you have forsaken God and turned to something else." I recognize that Israel was a spiritual nation, but there is some application there. You see it? Yeah. Acts 18:2 says, Paul, being Paul, found a Jew named Aquila, native of Pontus, having recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had commanded all Jews to leave Rome. The Roman Caesar kicked every Jew out because they were labeled as problem. They expelled them. You've heard it said, I'll let you finish the quote, Nero fiddled as Rome burned. In the summer of AD 64, Rome suffered a terrible fire that burned 6 days and 7 nights, consuming almost 3/4 of the city. Can you imagine a fire burning a week long? The people accused Caesar, Nero, for the devastation, claiming he set fire for his own amusement. In order to deflect these accusations and placate the people, Nero laid the blame for the fire on the church. He ordered the arrest of Christians who, under torture, accused others, until the entire Christian populace was implicated and became fair game as retribution for what the king was responsible for. And history says they took pitch, that stuff you put on your roof to seal the shingles. They put pitch on Christians and set them on fire to light up Nero's orgies and nighttime parties. Yeah, that's what history says he did. Harry Truman said, "The fundamental basis of this nation's laws was given to Moses on the Mount, Mount Sinai. The fundamental basis of our Bill of Rights comes from the teachings we get from Exodus and from St. Matthew, from Isaiah and St. Paul." Hear what he's saying? He's saying our Bill of Rights, our amendments, comes from Matthew, Isaiah, Exodus, and Paul. When have you heard that lately? Then he went on to say this, "I don't think we emphasize that enough these days." That's true, Harry. If we don't have a proper fundamental moral background, we will finally end up with a totalitarian government which does not believe in rights for anybody except the state. Did you hear what he said? He said, if we don't have a fundamental background properly, we will end up with a totalitarian government which does not believe in rights for anyone except the rights that the state gives you. He's right. Human rights don't come from government. They come from God. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are the pursuit of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. All men are created equal, and they're endowed by their Creator with certain rights. Our rights don't come from government. They come from God. 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, "Now the Lord is Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty." Now the Lord is Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. You believe that? You know it's true, don't you? The only real liberty is with the Lord. I misspoke last week. I attributed a quote of Nathan Hale to Patrick Henry. It belongs to Nathan Hale. He was put to death by the British for being a spy. He said, "I regret that I only have one life to lose for my country." And then he was hanged in 1776. I'll tell you right now, I'm not going to roll over and be a capitulator or a compromiser. I'm going to stand for God, His truth, and His word, no matter what happens in this country. My loyalty is to Jesus and to Him foremost and first of all, because in Him is where the only liberty is found.